Alrighty then, once again, XDL.com is very, very happy to, we're going to engage in an organic interview with one of our favorite artists and with someone who apparently is a musical and otherwise collaborator. We're sitting here with Avery Sunshine and Dana Johnson.
Yes.
So we're glad to have you both here. And this is happening by courtesy of Shanaki Records and Monifa Brown, who we love dearly, who arranged all of this for us.
We do too.
So we have a lot of things that we want to talk about in a short period of time. Yeah. So why don't we just get right down to it? And the first thing I wanted to ask you about is, now you're living in the ATL these days,
yes,
right? But you are originally from Philly,
yes, right? Chester.
Chester,
nine
that's outside
south.
Of...
9 miles south of Philly. My father told me I had to say it that way.
Nine miles
south of Philadelphia.
So my question to you is, what is it about Philly? Is it something in the water? Why do you get all these, like, you know, talented, and not only, like, in R&B, you know, historically, but a lot of jazz artists, you know, came out of Philadelphia, and some pop people, too. So
yeah.
What is it about that environment?
I don't know. I wish I knew what it was. This is what's so funny is I've been away from there for, I left when I was 18, and I can go to different places in the world, and they say, you sound like you're from Philly. And I was like, what? I don't know what that sounds like. I don't know what it is. And I know I sang with my introduction into the industry and the Philly, some of the Philly sound. I sang with the Wilmington Chester Mass Choir, which was a really big recording choir back in the day. Darryl Coley, they actually had some stellar wins. The song He's Preparing Me, Sovereign, some really big things. And that was my introduction to the music industry, and I don't know what it is about Philly, the water, the cheesesteaks, I don't know.
Cheesesteaks, Geno's or Geno's?
No, neither. No, you have to get it from the corner.
Oh, really?
Any corner.
All right.
You don't want to go to the ones that they show you on TV. I don't know, you want to go to the corner store and get it from there. It's greasy, you know, all the grease.
So now we have some culinary tips.
Yeah.
Direct from the artist.
Absolutely.
So let me ask you, now you left Philadelphia to go to Spelman.
Yeah,
is that correct?
I did.
So why Spelman?
Because my brother went to Morehouse.
All right, that says it all.
He told me there was nowhere else for me to go.
He's a Morehouse man.
Morehouse man. He told me there was nowhere else for me to go.
All right.
And we went to Fisk. As a matter of fact, I did apply. I applied to Fisk, Clark Atlanta, NYU, North Carolina A&T, and Spelman. And I was not accepted at Spelman. Every other school accepted me. They got a call from the music department, the chair of the department. Oh, Denise, we'd love for you to join the music department at Spelman. I got a rejection letter. They called, we thought about it. We'd love for you to join the department. What?
And that's what you did?
That's what I did.
Now, who's that bad brother down there? Joe Jennings,
Mr. Jennings. I think he just retired too.
Oh, really?
He was great. I took orchestration with him, and my writing partner at the time, and my best friend's sister, Maya Wilson. We stayed in the department for 24 hours because we had not done any work the whole semester. 24 hours finishing our final. And I chose the most difficult piece I could find. And the orchestra, I mean the most difficult piece I could find to orchestrate. I don't know why I did that. I wish I could find that stuff today. And we got through that night listening to Michael Jackson's Off the Wall record. Yeah, they locked us there and know we were in there.
No kidding. Joe Jennings, now he trained Tia Fuller. I don't know what
Yes, he did. Absolutely. Tia Fuller's my sister.
Yeah, she's bad.
And she's playing with everybody.
And her sister is bad, too.
I don't know her sister.
Okay, well you gotta check them out. Because when Tia first got here, she had an all-female band.
That's right.
And she got
rid of
the drummer and hired a brother-in-law, Rudy Royston.
Okay.
But her sister is Shammy Royston. Yeah, she's bad too.
Really?
Yeah,
Pam. I'm not surprised.
All of that. Okay, so I wanted to kind of ask you, okay, you know, ask you and Dana as well, okay, how do you typically collaborate with one another? Do you sit down at the piano and you pick up your guitar and just kind of like start jamming, or like, you know, does one or the other come up with like a full-blown idea, or what's your process?
It really varies. It really varies. I mean, it on one end, it could be that, you know, I might have an idea on guitar and we elaborate, or sometimes it just like almost drops in our lap, like it just spontaneously happens all at once. But I would say the majority of the time it comes from an idea that Avery or I have, that's just maybe chords or a melody or something, and then over the course of, you know, sometimes a couple of days or as long as a couple of years, even, it will evolve into a song.
Yeah,
I think everybody works differently. I start with drums.
Okay? Really?
Drums, okay? Yeah. And then, like, drums dictate what else happens in the music for me, because I'm a frustrated drummer. Yeah, I only play saxophone because my mother couldn't afford to let us have drums.
Right.
Okay, so how often when you're writing, because you said sometimes an idea will come and it will like marinate, you know, or percolate for years. Do you ever have an occasion where like the song comes to you all at once, all in one piece?
Yes, absolutely. Ugly Part of Me from our first record was like that.
Yeah.
Won't You Try, the first song on the upcoming record, May 22nd, Shawnee Q Records, Walmart.
Shameless plug.
You know, the first song. Dana was playing. He said you started playing it
backstage
Union Chapel in London.
Yeah.
And I didn't remember that, but the next time he played it, the words and everything just came.
So when you come up with a melody, how do you decide where it's going to go harmonically? Or does the melody just dictate to you what the harmony is going to be?
Yeah, the melody dictates it. And what he's playing dictates the melody. And it changes, it varies, but with that song, what he was, the accompaniment dictated the melody, and then from the melody dictated the background, and it just, you know, I feel like that's life though. You just kind of, and he's been telling me lately, just be like water, if you allow the process to be like water, it'll tell you where to go, tell you what to do. You don't have to force it. I've tried to force it, and it's been bad. You know, you don't want to hear those recordings.
See, that comes right out of Victor Wooten's book. Okay, so if you guys haven't read it, you're
also, haven't read it.
Oh, you as a musician, you just have to.
Really?
Have to. Okay, yeah, I recommend it. It's not a plug for Victor Wooten, okay, or his music or whatever, but the book. Okay, I recommend it to anybody that participates in music.
Absolutely.
The process. First thing I learned is that the space is as important as the note.
Absolutely.
Okay, and they don't teach you how to read spaces.
Absolutely.
They just teach you how to read notes. Okay,
absolutely.
So you'll get around to that one of these days. Well, you know, Avery, you have like a reputation for being an accomplished instrumentalist. Why do you think that artists who can actually play instruments don't release instrumental tracks? Do you think it's kind of like out of vogue, or you think like maybe it's because there's a perception that the public, you know, doesn't particularly appreciate instrumentals?
Absolutely, that's part of it. Some of them, they don't think the public, that's one thing, they don't think the public wants to hear that from them. Two, some of them are not comfortable enough with those gifts. They feel like it's going to be, maybe that's not enough.
Well, I'm not talking about the people that just can like sit at the piano and doodle, and I'm not going to name any names, but I'm talking about people that can actually, like, you know.
No, but I think that's some of it too. A lot of talented musicians don't think that they're that talented.
Wow.
And it's, you know, and I'm not speaking for everybody, but I say that as one person who I was that person. I said, I don't play. A lot of times our musician friends that we invite to come in and play, you know, Daniel Moore, one of our great friends, one of the guys who's contributed to both of the albums, he'd say, an amazing musician, amazing, I mean, just awesome. I said, I want you to play all the piano stuff. He was like, I'm not doing it. You play. I'll play around what you've done, but you set the foundation. I was like, see, but I don't play as well as you do. He says, no, but you play like you.
And having an identity is like an unmatched gift in music. You know, there are people, you know, another person I was thinking about when I wrote this question, I was Cy Smith, okay? And I don't know how you feel about her, but I saw her in performance, and I didn't know that she could play. But yes, she can, for real, okay? And so I guess that leads to my next question. Do you think being an instrumentalist makes a singer a better singer? I mean, for example, in jazz music, I can tell, or at least many listeners can tell, that when you're listening to a singer that actually has some instrumental training, there's a young woman who's fantastic named Jasmia Horn, and she's she's starting to make a lot of noise. And I saw her, and I was sitting next to my trumpet player, listening to her, and at the end of the thing, we looked at each other and was like, yeah, we know she plays piano, because when she was improvising, she was singing chords and extensions.
Exactly. Okay?
And so, you know, I know that in that genre of music, you know, having, like, you know, an instrumental background, you know, gives you a leg up, but...
It depends. Because I know a lot of amazing singers who might not know what to call it, but they'll sing a seventh or...
an extension, like a ninth.
An extension, or, you know, and they don't know what it is. But they can sing it for you, you know, and they hear things that I don't hear, and I play. I will say though that it does gives me other options that maybe I wouldn't think about if I didn't play. Absolutely, but it depends. It depends. I think it does depend. Yeah, like when you sing, does it help?
Well, at first I don't sing, but I think that.
Let us be the judge of
it. We got him singing though. We recorded a thing in Amsterdam, a radio show, and I got him doing some James Brown. He was my who did the background stuff with James Brown.
What's the assignment, Bobby? Bobby.
Bobby.
Yeah, what's Bobby's? I don't know. I can't remember. Oh. But the what we were saying was I think that when you have, it's like playing two instruments at the same time, and you know when you can sing and play, and you can align one instrument with the other one, so make this instrument can you know support compliment what the other one, complement what the other one's doing. So I think that it gives you other options. Mm-hmm. You know, it doesn't make you a better singer. I don't know, but it definitely gives you some more options. Yeah.
Like more weapons in your arsenal.
Yeah.
Now, obviously, we're going to talk about the new recording, and it's coming out this month in a couple days, actually.
Yeah.
But before we do that, I'd like to talk about the first album, because you left us hanging for about 4 years, didn't you?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I listened to, someone who's, one of my partners at XLL.com turned me on to your music. And she's like, "Oh, you gotta listen. Oh, this girl can sing." And I'm like, "Yeah, okay, I'll listen to her." And so I listened to All in My Head, and then I'm like, "You know what? Yeah, she can sing." Mm-hmm. And what struck me though was the lyrics were not what I expected. Okay, mm-hmm. I have become accustomed, I suppose, to hearing, you know, like, I won't cry, or whatever, and all the rest of this kind of stuff, okay, you know, where it's like always, you know, the brother's fault, and it's like, you know, whatever, and All in My Head was so refreshing, lyrically, simply because here was somebody, the person who's telling the story in song, acknowledging that, like, maybe, you know, they need to correct something about themselves.
Yep.
Okay. So tell us a little bit about that song.
Yeah, I was going through my divorce when we worked on that album. So there was a lot of, after I finished doing this to my ex-husband and I went to counseling and I had to do that, I had to deal with it. I had to get it out somehow. And I didn't go to a lot of counseling, but I went a couple different times. And in that second time, you know, the counselor said, "Do you think that maybe you had something, just like it was yesterday, that you had something to do with the demise of the relationship?" I was like, "That never occurred to me." And I the best way I could deal with that was to talk about it, like, "Hey, I'm sorry. Sometimes I be tripping. I know it was me." And just like with the ugly part of me, same thing. You know, I was acting crazy. I'm sorry, it wasn't all you. And I, you know, I, you know, I want to be in a healthy relationship. And in order to do that, I've got to talk about everything, not just his part. I have to talk about my part. And it just seemed easy to do that with the music. It seemed really easy to just talk about it and get it out and laugh at it too.
Well, time allows you to laugh at it. I don't
Absolutely.
Think you can laugh at it when you're going through it, okay?
I was doing some laughing at the time, so I don't believe this. They told me not to do it, and I did it anyway.
Well, life is the best, and experience is the best teacher.
Absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
So, on the first album, who produced that? Did you use a number of different producers, or was it just two of
them? It's us.
Okay, and is the same process with the new one?
Yeah.
For the most part, we did use some other producers. We used Clarence T. Lee Gill.
For Sweet Afternoon.
For Sweet Afternoon, and he's an amazing composer, instrumentalist. It actually has an amazing project called Four Corners.
This group is called, this band is called Four Corners. They are a mashup of Chick Corea slash the Yellow Jackets slash Herbie Hancock.
So far, so good.
Yeah, amazing. Ooh, stuff. But he did that particular track, and then another producer,
Damian DeSandys.
Time to Shine. Yeah. And he's another amazing multi-instrumentalist. He played every single... When I first heard the record, I was like, that sounds great. But the demo, I said, that sounds great. But clearing all those samples is going to be a problem. He's like, oh, no, there's no samples.
Well, I played all this stuff.
I was like, no, there's no way. He went track by track and showed me what he did. I was like, man, this is phenomenal.
I'd hate to be the one to break it to him, but you still got some copyright issues, even if he played all the samples. But it's a conversation.
It wasn't. I didn't feel like they were samples because I had heard them before. The quality of and the authenticity of the period thing that he did
made it sound like he got
it from something. Yeah. And then where it came from, he was turned on to us by DJ Jazzy Jeff.
Okay.
So I felt like, okay, clearly they must have sat down and pulled this stuff off some old records or something. But he's like, nah, this is all, I played all
his
this
creation.
Stuff. And it wasn't, it didn't seem like, I didn't recognize the music. It was just that the sound of it sounded so authentic and sounded so spot on in terms of the period thing that he was going for that I just couldn't believe that he did that.
And he did.
So in addition to being largely self-produced and you have like a close circle of friends, it sounds like, you know, or associates that you, do you solicit material from other people that you don't know?
Not really, but if it comes to us, we put out, and what we attract, we wait for that. Is that the best way to say it? We'd rather it come to us and say, hey, well, I'm looking for some tracks, and I need it to kind of sound like, we don't know.
Yeah, and frankly, to be honest, we kind of tried that. We tried, hey, we're looking for...
When?
Well,
I didn't try.
Well, we went, let me say it a different way.
I'm sorry.
That we went through a period where we were trying to make sure that the music was successful.
Exactly.
And there were some.
But we thought.
There were artists and producers that we dealt with that we thought
would give us
a particular kind of thing. And when we tried it, it didn't work.
Well, it wasn't you then.
It really didn't feel like it. And then we found that, you know, and there's so many, I had a good friend of mine, a guy by the name of George Littlejohn, who lives here in New York.
I know George. Yeah. I've known George for about 1,000 years.
Yeah, so I've known George maybe not quite 1,000 years, but some years. And you know, during that time I was talking to George, and he said, yeah, that's cool, but why do you guys feel like you need producers? Like, why don't... What you have is already great. He's like, yeah, George, but you know, we need the sound. He was like, yeah, I hear you. I don't agree though, but do what you need to do. But I think y'all are cool. You don't need writers. You don't need producers. Do what you do. And I didn't really appreciate it until later. Now we do get quite a few people that say, hey, I got a song or I got a track for you or whatever, and that's great. And we always appreciate it. And I always say, you know. I would love to hear it, you know, and we listen to it, but we find that the music that resonates the most for us, and that's not because we're snobbish or anything, but the music that resonates the most for us in most cases is the music that we create, because we make stuff that we like.
Absolutely.
And that's what it is, you know. Not that the stuff we get is not awesome, it's just that it's not exactly, you know, we've I guess spoiled ourselves by treating ourselves to exactly what we like. And so it makes it very difficult to get stuff from other places.
Yeah.
Well, I would also think that you're blessed enough that you can be independent and not be reliant on somebody else, because there are any number of folks out there that without outside producers, they have not much to say.
So
consider yourself fortunate. Now tell us about the new record. Okay, first of all, tell us what the title is and the date it's coming out. And Shanakee Records, shout them out once again.
Yes, on Shanakee Records on May 27th, 2014, The Sunroom, our sophomore project, will be out.
Now, why is it called The Sunroom?
Because we could not think of anything else to call that group of songs that had nothing to do with each other. And it really, we had, at that time, there were about three or four songs that we had. And we were in a small studio, maybe about the size of this room.
Yeah.
And one of our good friends, a guy by the name of Choreology, another amazing artist, he also does makeovers, room makeovers and all.
Interior design.
And the room is yellow, and he's got all this gray stuff in it, and he's black and white and red and purple color and all of that. And he's like, okay, you gotta name the studio something. And I'm like, it's called The Sunroom. The sun was coming in, it's great. And Dana said, you had an epiphanal moment, and you said,
that's the album name. We're going to name the album The Sunroom. And that's really how it happened. I said it just like that. The Sunroom.
He said it. I think I said it. But whatever the case is, it was said. And it was The Sunroom. And it makes sense because we got this group of songs that go anywhere from talking about, you know, one of I Do Love You. Dana's talking about his son. There's a conversation with God. He's, God, you're everything to me. Then there's another one, you know, won't you try? Telling your sisters and brothers, try love. Stop all this other foolishness. You don't have to put guns in there. Try love. You know, then there's another song in there. Any and everything we felt like talking about, we talked about on this record. And the only way to make it make some sense is to say, listen, in my sunroom, I can talk about whatever I want to talk about. And whatever that place is for you, my mother used to call it her secret closet. Denise, my birth name, Denise, I find that place where I go and I can think and do what I want to do. Might be in the car. Wow. So wherever that place is for you, we hope that this album encourages you to find it. And we hope that you know that you're not alone in your sunroom. And if you don't have one, get one. So we hope more than anything that people are inspired to shine from listening to The Sunroom.
So do you have a single that's going to be the first release from the album?
Yeah, well, we're thankful that Call My Name has been selected as the single.
Yeah.
And get some radio play, which is great.
Good. We're going to ask for your permission to play that on our site.
Absolutely.
Also, whenever the video comes out, you know we want to have access to that. I also kind of want to ask you, I guess before we bounce out of here, anybody that has access to the internet can go online and do a little research. So I kind of found out who you've named as some of your influences.
Yeah.
But what I'm interested in is, are there any artists out there that you're listening to who may have not yet come to the attention of the general public that you think are deserving of wider recognition?
Yes.
Who would you point to?
Oh, definitely our three artists, I think, of immediately. Four Corners, we mentioned earlier, Clarence T. Lee Hill and his band, Choreology, Daniel Moore.
Mm-hmm.
That's just three.
Yeah. There's so many good artists out there that for whatever reason, you know, don't do it. But
that are not just great on great recorded.
Yeah.
But they can perform live.
Yeah.
And to me, it's a whole package. And then nothing against anybody who just performs or they just record, but there is something else then you're able to make it translate. And those artists really they that's what I'm listening to.
I was gonna say some that we're also that we just worked with recently, Gregory Porter, who's pretty well known. But I say that name, and about 50% of the time, particularly in the States, people don't know who that is. I'm astounded by Raul Madon.
Raul Madon
is another one that amazing,
freakishly
artist.
Anointed and talented. Yeah. I mean, it's just. You were telling a little bit about the video, Sunshine?
Yeah, so I hadn't seen him live. I was familiar with some of his recordings, but as we were leading up to doing the show with him that we did in Chattanooga DC a few weeks ago, I was looking at some stuff online, and this guy is started off playing guitar, and then he took his right hand and started playing percussion while playing guitar, and then did this, like, trumpet solo with his mouth while doing these three things, you know.
An intricate, I mean, scale. I mean, he was doing a trumpet solo.
And if I could just be vulnerable and honest
Miles
for
Davis.
A moment.
I'm sorry.
So, at the show during soundcheck, I'm watching this guy soundcheck. And I'm like, man, how am I?
You got to follow this dude.
Yeah. Well, we actually opened, but I was like, how is that going to work? Like, what is I'm going
to
do?
What did he say to you? Could you
tell me? But so after the show, I told him that. I was like, honestly, I was watching a sound check and I was a little shook up. He was like, well, I can only play like I play. Mm-hmm. I can't play like you. Wow. And you're awesome at playing like you. And I was like, yeah, you're right. You know what I mean?
It's like snowflakes. No two are alike. Each one is individual, and every artist has something to contribute.
Absolutely.
That's the way the creator intended it.
Yeah.
Is there anything that I haven't asked you that I should be asking you? Is there something that you want to talk about that we haven't gotten to?
And you've been so great.
Yeah, I mean, just, I would say this, and that I admonish everyone to find that thing that they're great at and do that. There's been an amazing amount of happiness and freedom in finding my voice or our voice or whatever it is. And whatever that is, it doesn't have to be music. It might be you are the most awesome paper plane maker in the world. And if you just found that you are that and you put your effort into that, you probably would be happy and maybe even very rich, you know. And
so
I found the happy part. I'm working on the very rich part.
Or you're very rich. You might not have as much money as you would have, but I'm sitting here looking at a couple rich people. So
I take that.
We receive that.
Yeah.
We absolutely receive that. And we're just reflecting.
Well, thank you very much for taking the time to chat with us, and hopefully this is the first of a series of dialogues with you, because every time you guys do something and you're in a striking distance of X to the L, whether it's New York, Dallas, Texas, Memphis, Tennessee, because that's where we are, please, you know, visit with us and keep us in tune with what's going on.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much.
Thank
we
you.
Appreciate you.
And thanks again to Shanaki Records.
Thank you, Shanaki.
Thank you, Shanaki.
Last night I got mad. Things I shouldn't have.